All right, here it goes, this kick out stuff again. All right, I'm back. So I stopped out at this. When we say we're anointed and we say we have the anointing and I feel the anointing and that singer's anointed and that preacher's anointed and the anointing is in this place, the anointing, when we use that word, we forget about the reason and the logic behind God's anointing. And we think that the anointing is an accolade, some type of endorsement for you're doing well, you're being well, or you're reaching a certain place in God where you achieve certain things, I guess, that distinguishes you, right? But when God started dealing with me about the type of people we would forever attract, he took me to Isaiah 61 and showed me that there was an audience for the anointing. And in Isaiah 61, this is so interesting, when Jesus Christ preached this again, Jesus, this is the first thing he opened up when he made his presentation in the New Testament and said that the Spirit of the Lord was upon him, for he had anointed him. There was an audience in that. And in Isaiah 61, here is the audience of the anointing. If something, someone, someplace is really anointed, you're going to see these types of people. If you don't see these types of people around the environment or the person that is claiming the anointing, these people are not anointed. They are just talented, they are just gifted, or they have just done something well. But where there is an anointing, you will find certain kinds of people, and I'm going to prove it. I can tell if you are anointed by the type of people that's feeding off of what's on your life, not who you are. I can tell if your church is anointed by the type of people that continue to come for what's there and not those that are just sitting there. In Isaiah 61, what it says is this: the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because the Lord has anointed me. So the Spirit of God is upon the place that has been anointed. Number one, to proclaim the good news to the poor. So in every house of war, to every place where there's going to be an anointing, you are going to find the poor. You're going to find the poor in spirit, the poor in emotions, the poor financially. You're going to find those that have been robbed. You're going to find those that have been raped. You're going to find those that have had things taken from them, the poor. You're going to find those that are at a disadvantage to life, that are statistically disqualified for whatever reason. So you're going to find the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted. So that's another level of the people that are going to be there. If you don't have the brokenhearted around you, you're not anointed. You don't have the anointing. Your church is not anointed. Your preaching ain't even anointed. The brokenhearted, those that have had their lives fractured by painful events and painful circumstances and unforeseen griefs and terror and torment and turmoil, you're going to find the brokenhearted. To proclaim freedom for the captives. This is all the things the anointing achieves. If you are anointed and if your house is a house of war, you must have prisoners. So these are people that are currently in mental jails, emotional jails, spiritual jails, financial jails. If there is nobody in your midst that is struggling with their incarceration, then you are not anointed. Religious, churchy, good at what you do, but the anointing has a purpose. It has a logic. It has an audience, and the audience is not the people who wear long skirts and cover up all their pain. The audience is what I'm saying. The first one was the poor, second one was the brokenhearted, and this is the Bible. The third one is the captives. He says, and to release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of the vengeance of our God. This is just verse 2, and we already have about 4 different types of people in this audience. And in verse 2 of Isaiah 61, it says, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of the vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn. So these are 5 categories already in 2 verses that justify our need of the anointing. So if you are a house of war, you're going to have people that are mourning. Now, who mourns except somebody that has experienced a death? Who mourns except somebody that has experienced the death of a dream, the death of a future, the death of a hope, the death of a belief, the death of a future, the death of confidence, just death. You don't just mourn people, you mourn when things die. Another, it says to provide for those who grieve in Zion. There's grieving in Zion. So those that carry grief upon them in their personality, reality, in their expectations, in their attitudes. Now, this is just verse 2. So look at verse 3. He says to bestow upon them a crown of beauty instead of ashes. So if you're going to have the anointing, you got to have burn victims in the midst of you. This is how I know we've not really seen the anointing. We're just giving words to stuff and we have no scriptural backing. But the Bible says we've got to give people beauty for ashes. So that means that when people come to you, if you're anointed, they're going to be burn victims. They're going to have been burned down. They're going to have been lit on fire by demonic incarcerants and accelerants that burn them. Fires from life and fires from people and fires in their sexuality and fires in their passions and fires around them. Beauty to replace the ashes. So that means that when they come to you, they're going to be ashy. He says, I'm going to give them the oil of joy instead of mourning and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. So when people come to you, they will be in despair. They're going to have a spirit or a demon of despair. The KJV says the spirit of heaviness. And so the objective of this, after the end of all of this in verses 1 through 3 of Isaiah 61, the Bible says, and they ultimately will be called the oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor. So what that means is that God takes the 7 or 8 categories of people I just named and he makes them a plant. Something that he has worked on growing and something that he has dealt with root systems in order for them to bear fruit that can be eaten. The planting of the Lord. Our objective is to take burn victims, mourners, prisoners, the poor, the captives, all of those categories that Isaiah 61 means. Now, this needs to mean something to you because this was Jesus' first sermon. He could have picked any other portion of the scriptures to repeat or to preach about, but he turned to this place and said, look, I'm telling you what you should expect from me. I am a man of war. I am on a war assignment. I am on a war order. And because of this, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He's on my life and he has anointed me. So there is a reason behind the anointing, and the reason behind the anointing is the audience. So here is where the church went wrong. We went wrong not making space for the people who need the anointing. Church people don't really need it, but then I digress, they absolutely do, because many of them that are in church are there and not really delivered. They're not really free. They're not really whole. They're not the planting of the Lord. So a part of what our challenge is that we don't understand about why a house of war looks like how it looks. When the Lord rebuked me because I was offended about what those preachers said, the Lord told me vividly in my heart, he said, son, if you ever get to the point again where you are mad about what preachers are saying about who I've sent and you're not focused on who I've sent, I'm going to stop sending them. I pulled my heart right out of that mess, right out of that worry, so I'm no longer confused or concerned or care about who people come in the room being offended that people look crazy and got tattoos all up their neck and got piercings in their tongues. It doesn't offend me anymore when people are mad about there. Why? I understand that I am a house of war. And so because I am a house of war, the people that are going to come to my church are going to look crazy. Now, the difference between them and y'all is that y'all are crazy and I've just worked on not looking it. The people that come to us are crazy and don't know how to fake it yet. You've just had very good Christian theatrics that's helped you to cultivate your crazy and make it less offensive to other church people around you because y'all are more pleased in making each other satisfied than actually satisfying the Lord. And that's the same case that it was in the Old Testament when God had to tell Samuel, look, it's man that looketh on the outer appearance, but I am looking at the heart. So this is the what and the why of the house of war. The reason why you don't flow in deliverance is because you've not resolved to accept the people that need it. The reason why you don't see signs and wonders is because you want people polished and perfected. So yeah, as far as me and as far as all nations and as far as the gate, we want the crackhead, the alcoholic, the porn addict, the homosexual, we want the lesbian, we want the swinger, we want the stripper, we want the pimp, and he can bring his prostitutes. We want the meth addict, we want the people with the spiked hair, we want the people with the piercings in their tongue, I want people with tattoos. tattoos on their forehead, on their necks, on their foot. Y'all can keep those old faking choir wearing Roman Catholic mocking priests to carry your water. I'm going for the loss. Now, I was talking to a great friend of mine who was offended or who got confronted by some preachers that were mad because his church was getting so big, right? And a couple of people came up on him and was talking to him about who his church attracted. And he basically told them, I bait for the loss. And so if people come to me and they were a member of your church, they came to me because they were the loss. Every fisher of men has a certain bait that they are anointed to cast out. Jesus said, I'll make you a fisher of men, right? I'll teach you. All right, here it goes, this kick out stuff again. All right, I'm back. So I stopped out at this. When we say we're anointed and we say we have the anointing and I feel the anointing and that singer's anointed and that preacher's anointed and the anointing is in this place, the anointing, when we use that word, we forget about the reason and the logic behind God's anointing. And we think that the anointing is an accolade, some type of endorsement for your doing well, your being well, or you're reaching a certain place in God where you achieve certain things, I guess, that distinguishes you, right? But when God started dealing with me about the type of people we would forever attract, he took me to Isaiah 61 and showed me that there was an audience for the anointing. And in Isaiah 61, this is so interesting, when Jesus Christ preached this again, Jesus, this is the first thing he opened up when he made his presentation in the New Testament and said that the Spirit of the Lord was upon him, for he had anointed him. There was an audience in that. And in Isaiah 61, here is the audience of the anointing. If something, someone, someplace is really anointed, you're going to see these types of people. If you don't see these types of people around the environment or the person that is claiming the anointing, these people are not anointed. They are just talented, they are just gifted, or they have just done something well. But where there is an anointing, you will find certain kinds of people, and I'm going to prove it. I can tell if you are anointed by the type of people that's feeding off of what's on your life, not who you are. I can tell if your church is anointed by the type of people that continue to come for what's there and not those that are just sitting there. In Isaiah 61, what it says is this: the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because the Lord has anointed me. So the Spirit of God is upon the place that has been anointed. Number one, to proclaim the good news to the poor. So in every house of war, to every place where there's going to be an anointing, you are going to find the poor. You're going to find the poor in spirit, the poor in emotions, the poor financially. You're going to find those that have been robbed. You're going to find those that have been raped. You're going to find those that have had things taken from them, the poor. You're going to find those that are at a disadvantage to life, that are statistically disqualified for whatever reason. So you're going to find the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted. So that's another level of the people that are going to be there. If you don't have the brokenhearted around you, you're not anointed. You don't have the anointing. Your church is not anointed. Your preaching ain't even anointed. The brokenhearted, those that have had their lives fractured by painful events and painful circumstances and unforeseen griefs and terror and torment and turmoil, you're going to find the brokenhearted. To proclaim freedom for the captives, this is all the things the anointing achieves. If you are anointed and if your house is a house of war, you must have prisoners. So these are people that are currently in mental jails, emotional jails, spiritual jails, financial jails. If there is nobody in your midst that is struggling with their incarceration, then you are not anointed. Religious, churchy, good at what you do, but the anointing has a purpose. It has a logic. It has an audience, and the audience is not the people who wear long skirts and cover up all their pain. The audience is what I'm saying. The first one was the poor, second one was the brokenhearted, and this is the Bible. The third one is the captives. He says, and to release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of the vengeance of our God. This is just verse 2. And we already have about four different types of people in this audience. And in verse 2 of Isaiah 61, it says, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of the vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn. So these are five categories already in two verses that justify our need of the anointing. So if you are a house of war, you're going to have people that are mourning. Now, who mourns except somebody that has experienced a death? Who mourns except somebody that has experienced the death of a dream, the death of a future, the death of a hope, the death of a belief, the death of a future, the death of confidence, just death? You don't just mourn people, you mourn when things die. Another, it says to provide for those who grieve in Zion. There's grieving in Zion. So those that carry grief upon them in their personality, in their expectations, in their attitudes. Now, this is just verse 2. So look at verse 3. He says to bestow upon them a crown of beauty instead of ashes. So if you're going to have the anointing, you got to have burn victims in the midst of you. This is how I know we've not really seen the anointing. We're just giving words to stuff and we have no scriptural backing. But the Bible says we've got to give people beauty for ashes. So that means that when people come to you, if you're anointed, they're going to be burn victims. They're going to have been burned down. They're going to have been lit on fire by demonic incarcerants and accelerants that burn them. Fires from life and fires from people and fires in their sexuality and fires in their passions and fires around them. Beauty to replace the ashes. So that means that when they come to you, they're going to be ashy. He says, I'm going to give them the oil of joy instead of mourning and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. So when people come to you, they will be in despair. They're going to have a spirit or a demon of despair. The KJV says the spirit of heaviness. And so the objective of this, after the end of all of this in verses 1 through 3 of Isaiah 61, the Bible says, and they ultimately will be called the oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor. So what that means is that God takes the 7 or 8 categories of people I just named and he makes them a plant. Something that he has worked on growing and something that he has dealt with root systems in order for them to bear fruit that can be eaten. The planting of the Lord. Our objective is to take burn victims, mourners, prisoners, the poor, the captives, all of those categories that Isaiah 61 means. Now, this needs to mean something to you because this was Jesus's first sermon. He could have picked any other portion of the scriptures to repeat or to preach about, but he turned to this place and said, look, I'm telling you what you should expect from me. I am a man of war. I am on a war assignment. I am on a war order. And because of this, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He's on my life and he has anointed me. So there is a reason behind the anointing, and the reason behind the anointing is the audience. So here is where the church went wrong. We went wrong not making space for the people who need the anointing. Church people don't really need it, but then I digress, they absolutely do, because many of them that are in church are there and not really delivered. They're not really free. They're not really whole. They're not the planting of the Lord. So a part of what our challenge is that we don't understand about why a house of war looks like how it looks. When the Lord rebuked me because I was offended about what those preachers said, the Lord told me vividly in my heart, he said, son, if you ever get to the point again where you are mad about what preachers are saying about who I've sent and you're not focused on who I've sent, I'm going to stop sending them. I pulled my heart right out of that mess, right out of that worry. So I'm no longer confused or concerned or care about who people come in the room being offended that people look crazy and got tattoos all up their neck and got piercings in their tongues. It doesn't offend me anymore when people are mad about there. Why? I understand that I am a house of war. And so because I am a house of war, the people that are going to come to my church are going to look crazy. Now, the difference between them and y'all is that y'all are crazy and I've just worked on not looking it. The people that come to us are crazy and don't know how to fake it yet. You've just had very good Christian theatrics that's helped you to cultivate your crazy and make it less offensive to other church people around you, because y'all are more pleased and making each other satisfied than actually satisfying the Lord. And that's the same case that it was in the Old Testament when God had to tell Samuel, look, it's man that looketh on the outer appearance, but I am looking at the heart. So this is the what and the why of the house of war. The reason why you don't flow in deliverance is because you've not resolved to accept the people that need it. The reason why you don't see signs and wonders is because you want people polished and perfected. So yeah, as far as me and as far as all nations and as far as the gate, we want the crackhead, the alcoholic, the porn addict, the homosexual. We want the lesbian. We want the swinger. We want the stripper. We want the pimp, and he can bring his prostitutes. We want the meth addict. We want the people with the spiked hair. We want the people with the piercings in their tongue. I want people with tattoos on their forehead, on their necks, on their foot. Y'all can keep those old faking choir robe wearing Roman Catholic mocking priests to carry your water. I'm going for the lost. Now, I was talking to a great friend of mine who was offended or who got confronted by some preachers that were mad because his church was getting so big, right? And a couple of people came up on him and was talking to him about who his church attracted. He basically told them, I bait for the lost. And so if people come to me and they were a member of your church, they came to me because they were the lost. Every fisher of men has a certain bait that they are anointed to cast out. Jesus said, I'll make you a fisher of men, right? I'll teach you how to fish for men. That's the problem. We are not fishers of men. We have not resolved that the reason we are in a war to begin with is because there is a competition over souls between light and darkness, heaven and hell. What we're doing is we just move, you know, from church to church and recycle. But when you throw for the lost in the church come, the lost in the streets come, the lost in the politics come. If they're lost, they come. So I don't steal people's members. Not at all. I don't even go to people's church. I refuse to go to most of these churches in the city. I don't talk to none of the preachers, really. I got like maybe three I talk to. So I sit in my boat and I cast bait. And I preach things that catch the lost. I teach things that catch the lost. I minister to the lost. I embrace the lost. I don't go trying to recruit talent in other people's churches, trying to fill positions in my house. I have never had to do it. I have never even had to put a classified ad out to make somebody take a position in my church. I'm a fisher of men. I don't leave the boat. I stay in the boat and I bait. And the people I bait for is the lost, the wounded, the brokenhearted, the dead, or the dying. There was a unique anointing on my life for resurrection. And so because of that, you know, that whole these dry bone lives, because of that, people normally come to me when they're dead or when they're dying, either one. Now, they're not perfect. They've got demons, but we flow in deliverance. So that's the reason why we are a house of war, is because there is a species of people that church people look over, and we want to meet him at the door with oil. We want to meet him at the door with doilies and meet him at the door with all white and meet him at the door to find out if they were baptized in Jesus' name or not. We want to meet him at the door and find out whether or not they take communion on the first Sunday. We want to meet him at the door. We want to meet him at the door, but these people are not even convinced that your God is God. As a matter of fact, TV has made them look really bad, and y'all have helped them to look really, really bad. So y'all been so goddamn brainwashed about who should be coming in the church and what they should look like that you're more interested in what they're wearing than what their war is. So at my church, we are not as interested in what you're wearing as much as we are interested in what your war is. When you come into a house of war, one of the things we're trained to do is spot your personal war. And we reach for you in the war, and we help you in the war, and then we help you discern the war you were born for. So this is why you may see a little bit of everything at All Nations, but here is my guarantee. The everything you see ain't gonna look like that in about a year or two. You will see trophies presented to God as proof that he is still alive, he is still well. So I can't guarantee you that if you come in All Nations, you may see a dude with some tarantula eyelashes on, or you may see a young lady who looks like a man. You may see some of that. because I don't kick them out. Now, they're not going to function in ministry and over my leadership, but you're going to see them and they're going to be there and I'm going to hug them and we're going to embrace them and we're going to put them close to us and love on them and cast demons out because that's who we're anointed for. But I can guarantee you, as surely as Jesus is Lord, give me a year, 16 months max, and these people will not look like what they look like when they've come in the door. Not saying it to be proud. I'm saying it because we've got a track record. The difference between us and them is change. So y'all are beating them at the door. White. Don't come in there with that. Ain't no women with no pants on in hell. You can't wear no pants. Don't you walk down this old stupid middle aisle. That's the aisle that Jesus is going to come back. Let's rope it off. Don't walk down the center aisle because when the Lord come back, he coming down that aisle. So don't walk out. All this old stupid religion. And we are not invested in deliverance, curse breaking, prisoner freeing, the casting out of demons, healing, emancipation from the past, and the real perils that affect the people that God loves. So that's the what of the house of war. The what of the house of war is God's people are bound. His and the one he's trying to get. The human race is hurting. And if you are a preacher, a visionary that has been gripped by the condition of the human heart, and you are aware with how humanity as a whole is acclimated with pain right now, not only can you not afford to not be a house of war, but you can't afford to start trying to perfect people before they've been persuaded about God. So, yeah. That's why. I know it's not as deep as what you would hope, but that's the logic behind the house of war. And when you come into the house of war, you're going to see some black dudes with dreads in their hair in the pulpit. You're going to see people casting out devils with Jordans. Sometimes they'll have on suits. Other times they won't. You may see men with blonde hair in there, you know. You may see people with all kinds of stuff going on in their world. But guess who cares? I don't care. I am more interested in your war than what you wear. The church went wrong when they start being fashion consultants, telling you what to wear and what not to wear because they had no real authority over your war. So that's it. That is who the house of war attracts. That is the audience of the house of war. That's who we're going to have, and we're going to love them. So y'all can fight and argue over women wearing pants and all that and all that stupid stuff and makeup and gay men, and you know, y'all can fight over all of that. We're going to always grow because we want them with us. If y'all drop them, we'll take them. Come on over here. The hurt, the wounded, the broken, the bound, the demonized, the perverse, the crazy. Yeah, come on. I'll take you. Yeah. That's it, folks. If you're free Sunday, or if you're not free Sunday, Isaiah 61 is our scripture for tonight. But if you're free this Sunday, January the 31st, I want you to join us as we pay off our mortgage that we never got. Good riddance. We're going to be doing like this on Sunday. 2,000 people, $115. I want you to help us. We're going to get this big building and do some amazing things. I will be periscoping live from All Nations and Sunday, both at the 8:30 and the 11:30 service, to give you an opportunity to sow with us. But we are a house of war. Jonathan Nelson, good to see you, man. We are a house of war. It's what we do. It's who we are. I'm not going to change it. That's why we do what we do. We cast out demons. We break curses. We take all the folk that y'all reject. And that's what we do. All right. I love you guys. I will talk to you soon. Peace.